actually. We're even more than you are, you're also happy tonight. As mentioned yesterday, we'll talk tonight, inshallah, about al-khulu, about manners. And specifically, from some of the words of one of the a'imma of the deen, Imam Sa'di rahimahullah. And whoever read the tafsir of Sa'di, even though it's summarized tafsir, but if you get used to it, you see so much manners are being presented in such a way that really can be a life, or it is a life changing for those who reflect upon the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the entire deen of Islam is based on khuluq, if you understand it correctly. And this is a statement that Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah said. He said, إِنَّمَا الدِّينُ الْخُلُقُ إِنَّمَا الدِّينُ الْخُلُقُ Deen is خُلُقُ, is manners. فَمَنْ فَاقَ عَلَيْكَ فِي الْخُلُقُ فَاقَ عَلَيْكَ فِي الدِّينُ Whoever has more manners than you, that means he has more religion than you. And what he meant by this, once we think of manners, we think of what? Dealing with each other. This is just one type of good manners or manners that we are ordered to do. But the manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, manners with the Prophet and the manners with the different types of human beings that we have in our life, the subject of how to perfect all of this, this is the deen of Islam. The rights of Allah and the rights of the human beings. Every single matter of belief, it makes it clear, so clear, how the best manners that a Muslim has when he believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the right way. When a person worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we pray Salatul Maghrib today, this is the best manner to be observed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth, that He created everything. He's the owner of all things, and people are forgetful, not worshipping Him. This is under the category of bad manners. He's not the one that people are grateful to. They're deceiving themselves by being ignorant, arrogant, all these types of things. And instead of having the good manners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they be obedient to Him, submitting themselves to Him, following the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi to have the good manners with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi. Nobody on the face of the earth has more favor upon us among all of the human beings, more than the Prophet wasallam took us from darknesses to the light. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ We have not sent you except as a mercy to mankind. So therefore the good manners with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi is to follow Him. Is not to put forward our own opinions and likings and so on before the Sunnah, the way the Prophet ﷺ, and thinking that we know what is right and what is wrong and what works and what does not work. All of that is bad manners, really. Sins are bad manners. And the manners to deal with individuals, with one another, and that's also based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. But the subject of Husn al-Khuluq here that we're talking about, inshaAllah ta'ala, tonight is about dealing with one another. So when we talk about Tawheed, we're talking about the manners with Allah and so on. Now it's just husn al-khuluq, dealing with one another. And Imam Sa'di rahimahullah, in his book Riyad al-Nadira, Al-Hada'at al-Nayyar al-Zahira, he had chapters in Aqidah, chapters in manners. So in the chapter where he talks about the virtue of husn al-khuluq, he mentions the principles of the good manners, that is not just physical actions to be done, it's when things are done, of course, purely for the sake of Allah. And that's why we refer, inshaAllah ta'ala, to some of his statements. He said that the asas or the foundation of good manners, sabr, wal-hilm, wal-rahbatu fi makan al-akhlaq. To have patience and to have hilm. Hilm is forbearance. Not to be hasten in revenge when someone harms you. That's what Hilm is. One of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Halim. الَّذِي لَا يُعَاجِلُ بِالْعُقُوبَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Al-Halim, the most forbearing. That means He does not punish immediately. He gives people time and He forgives and so on. So to be patient, to have Hilm, to have forbearance, not to rush into want to revenge and want things for oneself. And to الرَّغْبَةُ فِي مَكَارِمِ الْأَخْلَاقِ And to have the رَغْبَة, the zeal, that she wants so much to achieve the best of manners. وَأَثَارُهُ And then the athar, or the outcome, or the fruits of this, and how it shows in one's behavior, is al-afr, to pardon, to forgive as-safh. And al-afu is that you would forgive, but still the traces of what that person did, it's still there. As-safh is when you forgive and it's gone, nothing whatsoever is left. Pardoning, forgiving, عن المسئين, those who harmed, or those who did evil and bad. وإصار المنافع للخلق أجمعين. So to pardon and to forgive, and to extend your benefit, to make sure that your benefit reaches to the entire world, to the creation of Allah. So this is the outcome of the good man. It's very easy to say. By the way, this was practiced perfectly by the Prophet ﷺ. We have the speech of the Prophet ﷺ and his actions. Sahaba radiallahu anhu, the imma of his deen, to show that again this deen is lenient, and that's why there's no ummah, there's no nation on the face of earth that it preserved the life and the actions and the things that happened and the lives of its leaders and the imma and ulama like this ummah. That's why whoever wants to see the manners of this ummah, go read about the people of knowledge in the books like Sayyir Alam al-Nubala by Imam al-Tahri rahimahullah, over 30 volumes. Just men, their names and what they said and who they took knowledge from and so on. And these are the men of the hadith, what the hadith, and those who saved, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them save this religion for us. And this is just one book from tens of books that has the same subject. So you would see the great men of these imma of this deen, those who understood and followed the way the Prophet said. And that's why we need to practice this and to read about them and to seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he says, فَوَاحْتِمَالُ الْدِينَيَاتِ وَالْعَفْوُ عَنِ الزَّلَّاتِ وَمُقَابَلَةُ السَّيِّئَاتِ بِالْحَسَنَاتِ. This is the manners of those who are really want to have the high level of good manners. And it's something that is going to be against our own desires, as we would hear, which is to be احْتِمَالُ الْدِينَيَاتِ. Dinaya is when someone transgress or someone do harm, you would take this with patience and with forbearance, and to forgive and to oppose as-sayyi'at, to oppose the sins with al-hasanat, not to oppose sins with sins. This is the norm of the human beings, and when they are tested, they always, usually, they will oppose sins with sins. But here, to oppose the sins that is done to you with hasanat or with good deeds. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in one ayah, he gives all of these meanings. In Surah Al-A'raf, خذ العفو وأمر بالعرف وأعرض عن الجاهلين. Three things that comprises the good manners, which is take al-afw. He says here the meaning of خذ العفو, أي خذ ما عفا وصفى لك من أخلاق الناس. Take from people what's extra and what's coming from them pure. Whatever they offer you, meaning in their behavior towards you of goodness, take that. And what it means is, يقول واقتنم ما حصل منها, take it, this is absolutely good. وغض النظر عما تعذر تحصيله منه. And غض النظر, low your gaze, that means ignore, make yourself not really as if you don't see what's happening from what they are not basically offering you of good manners. So if they have good manners towards you, this is something that is extended to you, take that, accept that. And what you expect of them, leave that away. Turn away from having expectations from people, whether it's the closest people to you or the furthest people from you. We all have expectations from others. We expect that people treat us nice, and if they don't, then we get angry for our own selves, and we get upset for our own selves. Anything that is for one's self, that's against the perfect husnul khuluq that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. To be perfectly good-mannered individual is to leave the matter, all of it, for the sake of Allah. Person is angry for the sake of Allah. He's happy for the sake of Allah. If someone do bad, he's not worried about his own self-rights. What worries him is that the orders of Allah has been broken. And this is what worries him. This is what makes him sad and so on. But as far as his rights, he let this go. It's not really, it's not one of his concerns. This is what he means. وَغُضَّ النَّظَرْ عَمَّا تَعَذَّرْ تَقْصِيرُ مِنُّهُ. Stay away from what you're not able to get from them. وَعَنْ نَقْصِهَا وَكَدَرِهَا. And even if they do good for you, it's always deficient or mixed with other things. Take that and be happy with it. And if you take this as an example from your one's wife or the wife to the husband or whatever there is, if she says a nice word, take the nice word. But if she says it and it's mixed with specific negative feeling, put that aside. Don't worry about this. Just take whatever is good from people and ignore and be forgetful from anything that is basically against what is best. And also the meaning of that, أن تشكر الناس على ما جاء منهم من الخير والإحسان, to be grateful to people from whatever good and ihsan comes from them, وما سمحت به طباعه من الخلق الطيب, and what their good manners and their nafs permitted for that to come to you. That means don't go extra, don't make sure that they would make it perfect. Whatever comes from them, you take that. ولا تطلب منه. This is why it's not just nice words. This is what a lot of work and a lot of struggle that a person has to go through to achieve this level. Maybe we can mention some of the examples of how the imam of this deen, they were like this. ولا تطلب منه. Do not ask from them. Do not ask them to have good manners towards you. If you ask them, you ask for their own benefit, but you're not really going after what is benefiting for your own self. ولا تطالبهم بما زاد عما حصل. And if they do something good, do not ask them for more or to perfect what they did to you. ولو كان لازما له. Even if it's by necessity, has to be there. فإنك بذلك تستريح وتريحهم. You will be happy and a very happy life, and you would also make them happy. Most of the problems and fights and issues is because of this. You expect from others to fulfill your rights in the most perfect way, and if they don't, you get angry with them. And they are the same way. So they're always like this, fighting with each other, and there's no happiness whatsoever. But if they take whatever comes and they are forgetful from whatever they don't get, with goodness in their hearts, everybody will be happy. يقول أما من كان يريد من الناس أن يكونوا كاملين مكملين لكل ما يحب لكل ما يحب ويستحب. And as for those who want from people to be perfect and to fulfill everything what is loved and what is to be loved, وإذا أخلوا بشيء من ذلك عتبهم. And if they don't be like this, he would blame them and start saying why is it not like this and so on. وأهدر ما جاء منه من الخير والإحسان. And he would, ahdar means, he would let go, or he would, what's ahdar? Huh? Waste. And he would waste what they did of goodness to him. They did good, but maybe that much. He would not even pay attention to this. He's more concerned about why it's not perfect, or from the harm that came, or whatever. So if he ignore what came from them from goodness, فَهُوَ عَنْ حُسْنٍ خُلُقِي بِمَعْزِلٍ. There is a barrier between him and good manners. He should not call himself someone that has good manners. This is not good manners. Good manners is not whenever things are good and happy and everybody's good and smiling to each other and they like this. He's away from husnul khuluq. وَلَا يَزَالُ مَعْهُمْ فِي نِزَاعٍ وَإِجَاجٍ وَعِتَابٍ. He will be like with these people with always arguments and fighting and so on. We see that clearly in our households. Very clearly. Why? Because there's no formalities and people have expectations. That means people have no good manners whatsoever. And they do not know what good manners is. Good manners is not when everybody's nice, then we're nice. Everybody does this. With decency, they have this. It's when people are not being nice, or they only give it a portion of niceness. You take that and you let go whatever you expect from them. يقول وإنما الحازم من يوطن نفسه على تقصير المقصرين ونقصان الناقصين. وقد أرشد النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إلى هذا الخلق. The real firm person is the one that would, this is the point here, is that the person would make himself وطن نفسه. That means you have worked on yourself enough that you already settled with this. That you know that people would not do to you what you expect them to do. It's a matter that it's done. So don't expect anymore. Not in a sad way, or not because they're evil or bad. This is the reality of your life. Take this and have this well established in you, and this is the right and this is the firm way to live one's life, is to be in such a way. And the Prophet ﷺ, he encouraged people to do this, especially with the example of the husband and wife. الحديث ان البروفيت صلى الله عليه وسلم مسلم لا يفرق مؤمن مؤمنا ان كره منها خلقا رضي منها خلقا اخر. Which means a believer, he does not hate his wife, meaning the believing woman. So the man does not hate his wife, in كره منها خلقا. If he hates a manner in her, he is pleased with another manner from her. So nobody has all perfect manners. People that have good things and bad things. So if he's pleased with some of her manners, this is what he focuses on. The bad manners, he ignores that. He does not hate her because of the bad qualities. And people, when they have disputes, they make the entire world as if this individual is the worst evil ever on the face of the earth. Well, it's because of one or two or three issues, and they ignore the good things. Why not focus on the good things? And the bad things, not even say, we'll work on it. Just leave it from your own perspective. But matters of deen, if it's something against the deen, yes, there is amr ma'roof, nahy munkar. You have to advise, you have the person has to work on himself. This is a definite thing, this is something else. But it's not going to make you, as an individual, hate and argue and fight and so on. You have the concern of how that person can save himself from the hellfire. يقول فأمر بالإغضاء عما فيها من العيوب. Prophet ﷺ ordered the man in this hadith to forgive or to forget and not to look into the deficiencies that his wife she has. وأن يكون نظره إلى ما فيها من المحاسن والمنافع. And his nazar, what he's looking at, what he's focused on the good things that she has. ويحمل هذا شفيعا لهذا. And the good things that she has intercedes for the bad ones, for the bad things. So the goodness of what she has would make him forget about the bad things. If the wife is a Muslim wife, she's wearing hijab, she does not go out of her house without the permission of her husband, and she's raising his kids, and this and that, and then she raises his voice against him, or she does this or does that, let these things go. And don't even think of it, and don't think that it's against my pride and this and that. Let the good manners be the thing that would intercede for her. When you're upset with her, remember the good thing, the many good things that would be in charge and be overpower the bad ones. يقول لأنه بذلك تدوم الزوجية. This is how marriage continues. That's why there are so many divorces. Why? Because the lack of knowledge of what حسن الخلق, this is deen, this is religion. So the same way we learn how to make salah, make wudu and so on, we have to learn how to live with others. We have to know how to have manners with the wives, with the people in the masjid, with whatever there is. So this is how the marriage continues. وتتم الصحبة الطيبة والصفاء. Even friendship and brotherhood and so on. ويقل النزاع والخصام. And the disputes will be very less as a result of this. And again, it doesn't mean to compromise the deen. No compromisation of the deen whatsoever. So for example, in the case of the wife, a sin, there's no way, no compromisation in sin whatsoever. The man is in charge of the household. Very clear in this matter. But with all good manners. And to forget and to forgive all of what she says and not to make it a matter of dispute and the like of this. And the same thing, of course, for the wife. يقول وقس على هذا الذي ذكره صلى الله عليه وسلم جميع المعاملات والحقوق. This hadith that we just said, make it as the principle that you make analogy to every single transactions and rights in your life. فالمعاملة بين الوالدين وأولادهم. The relationship between the parents and the children. إذا كانت على هذا الوصف, if it's according to what has been mentioned, حصل البر وأديت الحقوق, the righteousness will be there and the rights will be fulfilled. And it doesn't mean that you allow sins to be in the life of your son. There is no way. The deen of Islam has to be applied, but taking what is extra. إذا وطن الوالد نفسه على شكر ما حصل من ولده من البر. Now the specific subject of the child being righteous towards his parents. If the parent is satisfied and pleased with whatever righteousness that the son has, ولو قليلا, even if it's little, وعفى عن تقصيره, and he pardoned his shortcomings in this subject, is dead and dead. The righteousness will increase. The righteousness of the son will increase. وحصل الوالدين رحمة. and the parents will be delighted in us. And not to approve the sin, but to encourage them from what they have and to let go the matters of the lack of righteousness that they have towards you. فَرَحِمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ أَعَانَ أَوْلَادَهُ عَلَى بَشْرِهِ. So may Allah have mercy on the one that he would help his children to be righteous towards him. And this is a very good statement. Why? Because when you want so many, for example, from your children, and you know that they're not going to do it in the most perfect way, you are helping them to be, or to fall into the uquq, or to be disobedient to you. So you make it easy for them that they are righteous to you. And this is how the righteousness will increase. Instead of making them fall into what would make them fall into sins and major sins and so on. يقول وكذلك الأولاد, and also for the children. عليهم القيام ببر والديهم. They have to be righteous towards their parents, of course, in the most perfect way. وأن يوطنوا أنفسهم على ما ينالهم من الوالدين من سوء الخلق وشراسته. And they have to also يوطنوا أنفسهم. That means they have to establish this in their hearts, that this is not going to be once in a while, this is going to be the norm, that whatever comes from their parents, from bad manners towards them, and roughness, وَسَيُّ الْأَقْوَالِ وَالْأَفْعَالِ, and bad words and actions that comes from their parents, لِيُوَطِّنُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ عَلَى احْتِمَالِهَا. They need to make themselves well established that they would be forbearing for this. They will take it. They won't dispute it whatsoever. They won't be upset because of it. وَأَنْ يَشْكُرُوهُمْ عَلَى مَا نَالَهُمْ مِنْهُمْ مِنَ الْحِسَانِ مَا مَكِينَ. And they will be grateful to them from whatever ihsan and goodness that comes from the parents. So if a person knows that this is the deen, he has parents, he's already established on this. Not that when it happens we'll see what's going on, or how level of goodness or badness that they are. He's already well established that if the parents are saying bad words to him, doing evil, saying bad words, cussing, cursing, like this, he already established himself that he would be forbearing these things. He won't act in a different way. And at the same time, he's grateful to whatever good comes from them. فَهَذَا مِنَ الْبِرِّ وَالصِّلَةِ الَّتِي لَا يُوَفَّقُ لَهَا إِلَّا الْحَظُّ الْعَظِيمُ. This is righteousness and goodness that only those who have great fortune will be able to achieve this. When we're listening to this, we think that this is too much. Life does not go like this. Like people will take advantage of us. That means that this is all whispers of shaitan. As we said, the balance is when we're talking about someone in charge, that he would never allow for sins to be established in his household, but he has this level of good manners, this is what is meant. So there's to take it as a rule that would never change, this does not mean to commit sins or to allow to commit sins. This is all with perspective of that we're obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when it comes to our own personal benefit and feelings and all of this, let this go. Don't be too much concerned about what people are doing to you. Just be grateful to whatever comes from them. The same thing وكذلك حقوق الأصحاب والجيران والمعاملين. The same thing with the friends and the neighbors and those who work with you, to take the same path as mentioned. القناعة بما جاء منه. To be content with what comes from them. وتحمل ما لا يوافق الإنسان من قول أو فعل أو عمل. And to have تحمل, that means bear this, whatever comes from them, which you don't like from speech and actions. And see how we act when someone says a word that we don't like. It's a word, right? We don't let a word slip. What did you mean by this? And what do you mean by this meaning that he said something that can mean good or bad, right? What do you mean by this? Or are you saying this? So imagine when someone says clearly a bad word directly towards you in your face like this. How would we act? As a normal reaction for human beings, we get so angry. And it doesn't mean that we become like animals or something, that we don't have any feelings. It's a normal thing for a person to be upset. But how to act when a person is in that state? This is the difference between someone seeking rewards from Allah and someone is going after his own fortune and desire. And to look always at what's the benefit if I respond by a bad word, what did I gain from this? A sin, opposing a sin. And there's no benefit whatsoever. And as we would see, some of the amazing situations that happened for the Prophet ﷺ and the companions, the imam of this deen, they applied this in reality, and the outcome of it is amazing, especially if a person is doing that for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فبذلك تدوم الصحبة والتقوى وتقوى. That means this is how the relationships and the friendship, people in the same masjid. You know, you would find many disputes among people in the masjid because of a word here or there, or a transaction, or money situations, or he looked at me this way, or he even matters of deen. Like, I was supposed to give adhan and he chose someone else, or they chose someone else. Why him and not me? It's because my voice is bad, but then he quit coming to the masjid. Take whatever it comes from people, and whatever you don't like, forgive and pardon and have the good expectations of others, all for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if you think that you know with certainty that in the hearts of that person, and we're not supposed to, we do not know what's in the hearts of the people, that he hates you so much, leave it for the sake of Allah, with goodness, not just with having, carrying grudges inside of one's heart. One of the shaykh, he was saying that he was with Shaykh Ibn Baz rahimahullah, and he asked him, why people love you so much? Even his enemies, they, you know, he's someone that nobody had disputes with him, meaning everybody respected him and loved him. So the Shaykh tell him, you know, fear Allah what you're saying, or something like to stop him from saying this. He kept on insisting, he kept on insisting. Then at the end he said, the meaning of which, وَاللَّهِ لَا أَجِدُ غِلًّا فِي قَلْبِي تِجَاهَ أَحْدِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ. Says, وَاللَّهِ I have no hatred or any grudges towards any of the Muslims. And once I hear there's a dispute between two people, I rush to bring peace to them. And this is how the hearts would be connected. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the love in the hearts to the, this is how the people of knowledge were. So the point here is to take what is extra for when it comes to the personal level. But when it comes to matters of deen, there's no, again as we said, compromisation to the deen. So they would defend the deen, they would refute what is evil and those who are upon evil. But then when it comes to their personal manners and so on, this is another level as we will see inshallah ta'ala. And then he says, أَمَّا مَنْ كَانَ إِذَا جَاءَهُ مِنْ أَصْحَابِهِ أَوْ مُعَامِلِهِ وَنَحْوِهِمْ سَيِّئَةً وَاحِدًا. As for those who one sin comes to them from their friends or from their whatever the people is, أَهْدَرَ بِهَا مَا سَبَقَى مِنَ الْمَحَاسِنِ, he would drop and ruin and waste all of the goodness that came from them. It might be years and years of goodness and friendship and brotherhood and so on, and then once a year, and it's a year, it's evil. That person did bad to him, and it's not something that is not that it's bad, but one. فَهَذَا مِنْ أَعْظَمِ الْحُمْقِ وَقِلَّةِ الْوَفَاءِ وَعَدَمِ الْإِنْصَافِ. This is foolishness. If he would take that once a year versus all of the goodness that he received from him, this is foolishness, this is lack of al-wafa, to be faithful, and this is not fair. Because human beings are bound to make mistakes. Not just sins between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, between themselves and you. This is how being human beings. So the person has to again establish himself that this is how human beings are. This is how we are. And we do not see ourselves as being perfect to others. So why should people be perfect towards us? So, and وَمَنْ كَانَ بِهَذَا الْوَصْفِ فَهُوَ أَبْعَدُ النَّاسِ مِنْ حُسْنِ الْخُلُقِ. And whoever is like this, the one سيئة, one bad thing, changes him like this, he's away from husnul khuluq. So he need to go back and get himself well established on good manners. يقول المقصود أن المعاملة بين المختلطين والمرتبطين بحق من الحقوق. So the fact of the matter here is, those who are, people are mixing as human beings, we're not living in isolated islands, but we're mixing, we're having relationships and so on. If it's established on خذ العفو, take what is extra, and again the person will take this upon himself, he will be saved from all kinds of harm. And if it's established on al-istiqsa, the opposite of that, if the relationship is established on what the istiqsa, meaning that you don't let things go whatsoever, the small and the major and anything, then this leads to all kinds of evil. So this is khud al-af. This is the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Prophet and his ummah, and this is where the Muslim should practice this in his life. وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَهِلِ. خُدْ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ. He mentioned this, but first he goes, وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَهِلِينَ. Turn away from the jahilin, turn away from the ignorant ones. That means, إِذَا جَهِلَ أَحَدٌ عَلَيْكَ. If someone acted ignorantly towards you, with speech or actions, what's أَعْرِضْ means? أَعْرِضْ is that you give him your side, that means you turn away from him. فَأَعْرِضْ عَنْ مُقَابَلَتِهِ بِجَهْلِ, which means He's opposing you with jahl. Do not oppose him with jahl and ignorance. Turn away from the jahl, turn away from ignorance. And oppose him or face him بِمَا وَقَابِلُهُ بِمَا تُقَابِلُهُ بِهِ إِذَا كَانَ مُحْسِمًا فَتَكْسِبَ السَّلَامَةَ وَالْأَجْرِ. He's saying ignorant. He's acting towards you in an ignorant way. You face him with what you would face him with if he was muhsinan and goodness towards you. And this is again another level. You never hear that in this world. But this is what perfect good man is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. So imagine someone, you know, for example, you are in the road and someone cuts you off or something, or he's angry with you. So he's opposing you with anger, and he's opposing you with, as if he did a favor to you. Right? Not sarcastically, not to make you more angry, you really mean it. Or someone is very angry towards you or said something, and you're opposing with words of goodness. This is not going to make you a crazy person, or someone that is not in this world. This is what A'ra'an Jahili means. وَقَابِلُهُ بِمَا تُقَابِلُهُ بِهِ إِذَا كَانَ مُحْسِنًا فَتَكْسِبَ السَّلَامَةَ وَالْأَجْرِ. You'll earn from this a salama, to be saved from harm, and you'll earn a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حُسْنَ الذِّكْرِ. People will talk all kinds of goodness about you. Imagine, with, you know, a Muslim, for example, he would do this to someone that said a bad word to him. Imagine how people would be affected by this. How would they say things? وَلِتَّصَفِ مَكَارِبِ الْأَخْلَاقِ وَعَلِيَهُ. To have the high levels of men. So وَكُلِّ مَنْ عَصَى اللَّهُ أَوْ قَصَّرَ فِي حَقِّهُ وَتَعَدَّ عَلَى أَحَدٍ فَهُوَ جَاهِلٌ سَوَاءَ كَانَ مُتَعْمِدًا أَوْ غَيْرَ. Everybody that, anybody that disobeyed Allah or transgressed against the rights of others, he is jahil, he's ignorant, whether he intentionally doing this or unintentionally. So any ignorance is to be opposed with goodness and not to be opposed with ignorance. So وذلك أن العلم الذي يعمل الإنسان به هو العلم النافع والذي لا يعمل به جهله. That's why the علم is that the knowledge that we act upon, this is the benefited knowledge. And if a person is not acting according to it, that's ignorance. So a person has the knowledge but he doesn't act according to it, he's ignorant because he knows that he's not acting according to the knowledge. وقد تعوذ صلى الله عليه وسلم من علم النافع. The Prophet sought refuge in Allah from knowledge that is not benefiting. The second order is وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ. Order people to do الْعُرْفِ. الْعُرْفِ means that أَيْ لِيَكُنْ أَمُرُكَ لِغَيْرِكَ مَوْصُوفًا بِوَصْفَيْ. Let your orders to others, how you talk to people, how you give them orders or tell them to do whatever you want them to do under your authority or whatever, to be having or to have two qualities in your orders. The first one, أَنْ يَكُونَ بِرِفْقٍ وَحِكْمٍ. If you tell someone to do something, your child, your wife, whatever, to be with gentleness and with wisdom. وَأَقْرَبْ أَنْ يَكُونَ بِرِفْقٍ وَحِكْمٍ وَأَقْرَبْ بِطَرِيقٍ يُوصِلْ إِلَى هَذَا الْمَقْصُودِ. To be with gentleness, with wisdom, and the shortest way for that order to be fulfilled. So to make it easy for them to do what they're supposed to be doing. وَذَلِكَ يَخْتَلِفُ بِاخْتِلَافِ الْعُرْفِ. And this is, will be different from one عُرْف to the other, from one norm to the others. So you want someone to cut the grass. I'm just making up, maybe not the right example. This grass might be in certain norms. The easiest way to do it is this way. In the norm that you live in, the easiest way is to do it with a machine, for example. So don't say, no, I want my son to be tough. He needs to cut the grass the way that my grandfather used to cut the grass, so that you become responsible. You know, just make it easy. If you want your things to be fulfilled, you're not spoiling him, and you would help him for him to be righteous towards you. Right? So what more will offer? Order people to do what is the norm in their life, again, as long as it's not a sin. This is a huge principle in the deen, which is mentioned in many chapters of matters of fiqh, this issue of al-urf. The urf is a very well-established part of our deen. The norm, the cultures of the people, as long as it does not contradict the matters of deen. And some things people think it's not deen when it's deen. For example, holidays is deen. So nobody is to say, well, this is the culture of the people, that they celebrate Father's Day. No, Father's Day or whatever day is supposed to be deen. And the deen is only Eid al-Fitr, Eid al-Adha. There's no other Eids in our life. And there's no such a thing as deen versus culture. Eids are deen. any holidays, it's supposed to be only deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one that would have the right for people to celebrate this or not. So, but in the normal life of people, and this is also to be with knowledge and asking the people the knowledge. So this is the first way, with gentleness and with wisdom, and the shortest way, the easiest way for this to be fulfilled. And the second characteristics of wa'mur bil'urf, liyakun ma'muruka alladhi ta'muru bihi min al-umur al-mahbubati shar'an wa 'urf. Let the things that you say to them to do to be from the things that is loved religious wise and 'urf wise. So for things to be loved religious wise, this is obvious, and also to be loved in the norm of the people, they would love these things. But of course, if there is contradiction, you put forward the deen without any doubt. وَهُوَ الْأَمْرُ بِالْوَاجِبَاتِ. So you order them to do the obligations. So you make your children make their salah, do the good deeds and so on. المستحبات and the recommended acts from the عقائد, matters of belief and manners, and the actions that has to do with the rights of Allah and the rights of the human beings. We focus on this, and the same thing towards the wife. You know, be kind to this because this is for the sake of Allah. The things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves. So you tell people to do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them. So these two qualities, if it's there, that means you have husnul khuluq with the three things that is mentioned. And the Prophet, and that's why you will understand the hadith that talks about husnul khuluq. The hadith, by the way, that talks about husnul khuluq, the reward of it is an amazing one. And we think it's just to smile to someone and that's it, and we have husnul khuluq. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَقْرَبُ النَّاسِ مِنْ زِلَةٍ مِنْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَوْ أَقْرَبُكُمْ إِلَيَّ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَحْسِنُكُمْ أَخْلَاقًا. The closest among you to me in the Day of Judgment are the best among you in manners. This is the level that, where is this level in any other thing? And the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَبْلُغُ بِحُسْنِ خُلُقِهِ دَرَجَةَ الصَّائِمِ الْقَائِمِ. That the slave of Allah would reach with his good manners the level of as-sa'im, one that is fasting continuously, al-qa'im, the one that is doing the night prayer continuously, the entire night. How great reward that is, you would reach that level with your husnul khuluq. So that husnul khuluq is not just once in a while. It's what we talked about like this. Because this is what the manners of the Prophet ﷺ. And that's why when, for example, in wudu, the ayah says, faghsilu wujuhakum, wash your face. Where is the face? We know our face linguistically. No, we get to know what the face is to be washed from the actions of the Prophet ﷺ. So when there is differences of opinions among the ulama, whether the mouth and the nose is part of the face, or this is mustahab, only recommended, it's because of this. So when we say the correct opinion that when we make madmada and istinsha, that's rukn in the wudu. This is a pillar of a wudu, not extra. Why? Because this is from the face. But more importantly, because the Prophet ﷺ never missed it. He would always do the mouth and the nose. So the ayah says your faces, and the actions of the Prophet ﷺ showed us what is the face. So he would do the mouth and the nose and the face. So that means this is all part of the face. The same thing with wiping the head. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ. Wipe your head. Yes, the majority say part of the head. But when we look at the actions of the Prophet ﷺ, he would wipe his entire head going backward and forward, like this. So this is what is meant by وَمْسَحُوا بِرُؤُوسِكُمْ. This is what it means by wiping over your head. So the same thing when we talk about husnul khuluq is not what people in the 21st century get to know what husnul khuluq is. Is the manners of the Prophet ﷺ. To follow him, is it going to need sacrifice? Yes, who said that the deen is not based on sacrifice? We have to sacrifice. The sacrifice that we are ordered to have in this deen reaches the level where you might give your entire life for the sake of Allah. Isn't that the case with al-jihad fi sabilillah? They give their entire life, no more life, for the sake of Allah. And all of their wealth for the sake of Allah. And this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from the believers. So then when a person says, but I can't. Like I've heard this from a brother saying that about his mother, that he can't be nice to her. Someone like this, what would you say to him? Because she says this, or she does this, or she's treating him in a different way. What is then the deen is all about? And mashallah, salah and siyam and the first row and things of that nature. You can sacrifice in these things, but you cannot sacrifice to put your to make your mother put her foot, as they say, on your cheek, to humble oneself to your mother, the one that. And then when we mention the mother, then we can talk forever about how the virtues of the mother towards the children. It's enough that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the parents the means or the reason for one's existence. They're not the creators. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that created us. But He made them the reason for our existence. So there's nobody have more rights on us more than our parents. So the matter is not subjected to how they are treating us or not treating us or whatever there is. But the other extreme is when a person commits a sin because of his parents. He thinks that he's being kind to them. No, you're being evil towards them if you obey them in the sins. Because that means you are subjecting themselves to the punishment of Allah. Because this will be in the balance of their bad deeds. But they will be angry with me. Then be extremely kind to them. And this is where the sacrifice is. And this is what how we understand what Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, the man came to him and he said that my mother is ordering me to, or my father is ordering me to divorce my wife. So what did he say to him? He said, لا تطلق, do not divorce your wife, وأطع أمك, and obey your mother. Contradicting. But that's what it means, because it's not justified, unless it was for a valid reason. It's not justified for her to say that because the woman is righteous, whatever there is. So don't divorce your wife, but be obedient to your wife, to your mother. That means what? That means it's a lot of sacrifice. A lot of sacrifice to be extremely kind and righteous. Your kindness and righteousness to her will make her forget that you disobeyed her in this one particular matter. And even if she does not forget, that means you blame yourself. Maybe I'm not righteous enough. And so on. So, and this is the most thing that gets people to enter Jannah. As the Prophet ﷺ said, the taqwa Allah hasna khulub akthar ma yudkhil nas al-jannah. The most frequent thing that makes people enter Jannah, as the Prophet ﷺ said, taqwa Allah, the fear of Allah, and husn al-khulub, and good manners. Taqillahi haythuma kunt, wa atri'i sayyid al-hasad al-tamhuha, wa khalaq al-nasa bi-khulub al-hasad. Fear Allah, be dutiful to Allah, wherever you are, and follow the bad deed with the bad, with the good deed, it would wipe it, and treat people with husn al-khulub. There are more, inshallah ta'ala, because of the time, if we look at some, just without a particular order here, when you, and this is, I advise myself and everyone, this is where the ulama, they call it from the extras of knowledge, not necessarily something that a person would go listen to a dars about it. It's something that you would read before you go to sleep. When you're bored from studying so much, you would read these things, which is basically tarajim al-ulama wal-imma, to read about their life, the life of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Everybody can read this. It's no rulings here or something that a person would extract. But to go back and as if, because this is the ummah, this is our lineage, that we need to know their actions and so on. Imam al-Kasai, one of the qurra, that, you know, the reciters of the Quran, he's Imam at this time. And this is all from the book of Sayyid Amin al-Nubala, most of it. Imam al-Dahabi rahimahullah said, incident that happened to him, he was leading the salah, he was the Imam, and behind him Harun al-Rashid, the Khalifa. He's the Imam al-Kisai. So he's leading the salah. He says, فَأَعْجَبَتْنِي قِرَاءَتِي. When he was in salah, he liked his recitation. He's saying that about himself. فَغَلَطْتُ فِي آيَةٍ مَا أَخْطَأَ فِيهَا صَبِيٌّ قَطْ. He said, I made a mistake that not even a child would ever make that mistake in this ayah. أَرَدْتُ أَنْ أَقُولَ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ. Instead of saying لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعُونَ, he said, لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعِينَ. Something that nobody would ever say this one. Right? لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْجِعِينَ. Something that is, there's nothing the like of such a thing to be said. So يقول فوالله ما اجترأ هارون أن يقول لي أخطأت. Harun al-Rashid, he was not even he did not have the courage to tell him that you made a mistake. You know, any child would really find that this is a mistake. But when I made salam, he said, يا كسائي, he said to me, يا كسائي, أي لغة هذه, what language is this, what recitation is this? He thought this is something new. He said, قلت يا أمير المؤمنين قد يعثر الجواد. I said, oh, Amir al-Mu'mineen, the leader of the believers, the nice horseman can fall sometimes. It's a slip. He said, أَمَّا هَذَا فَنَعْ. He said, as for this, فَيَسْ. That means, you're right. Anybody can slip. If this is someone, Imam al-Kisai, that he knows the Qur'an, every word of it, every letter of it, لَا يُسْقِطُ حَرْفًا. There's no letter that he would fall from his memory, and an imam, that means these are from the counted ones that one of the recitations go back to him, and he would make a mistake like that. So that means this is everybody can make mistakes. But the point here is, Imam al-Dahabi rahimahullah, when he mentioned this, he said what? He said, مَنْ وَعْيَ عَقْلُهُ هَذَا الْكَلَامِ. Whoever his intellect and reason comprehend this very well, عَلِمَ أَنَّ الْعَالِمَ مَهْمَ عَلَى كَعْرُ. He would know that the alim, the scholar, no matter how high of knowledge he reaches, وَبَرَضَ فِي الْعِلْمِ, he is well established in matters of knowledge, إِلَّا أَنَّهُ لَا يَسْلَمُ مِنْ أَخْطَاءُ. But he would never be safe from mistakes. وزلات and slips. لا تقدح في علمه ولا تحط من قدره ولا تنقص منزلته. It would not take away from his knowledge, would not take down his level, and would not make him someone else if he makes mistakes. This is something that everybody would fall into this mistake, or mistakes in general. When we even, as a subject, without going into the details of this, and there are many examples of that, the life or the manners of the Prophet ﷺ with the munafiqeen, with the hypocrites, those that goals day and night is to destroy the religion. How the Prophet ﷺ treated them. Even though, when it comes to the religion, no compromisation, the matter is very firm, very clear. Would never allow them to be in even positions, or in way that would they affect others and so on. But his personal manners towards them is something amazing. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, for example, the head of the hypocrites in the Medina, the one that said all kinds of evil about the Prophet ﷺ and plotting and so on and so forth. When he died, the Prophet ﷺ, he prayed janazah on him, and after that he was forbidden. But he would not, alayhi salatu wasalam, take it as a personal thing till Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade him from making janazah on the munafiqeen. But the point here is, when the ayah even was revealed, إِن تَسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ سَبْعِينَ مَرَّةً فَلَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَهُمْ. If you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness within 70 times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would not forgive them. And this is in the ayah, وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِنْهُمْ مَاتَ أَبَدًا. Do not pray janazah upon on any of them, and so on. The Prophet ﷺ, when the ayah was revealed, he said, لَوْ أَعْلَمُ أَنِّي لَوْ زِدْتُ عَلَىٰ السَّبْعِينَ غُفِرَ لَهُمْ لَفَعَلْتُ. He said, I know that if I do more than 70 seeking forgiveness for them, and they would be forgiven, I would do so. But that means, of course, they're not going to be forgiven. But what kind of heart of the Prophet ﷺ, it was not a personal issue. It was for the deen, yes, and no compromisation in this. But when it comes to matters of personal matters, and this is the goal of this, is to purify our hearts from our personal gains when it comes to relationships and good manners and the like of this. Also, some individuals in the history of the Imam of the Muslimin also would be amazed when we read about their life and their forgiveness and so on. Like Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, Shaykh Hussain Taymiyyah rahimahullah, there was a very famous enemy to Shaykh Hussain Taymiyyah, Qadi ibn Makhluf al-Maliki. He was someone that he made takfir of Shaykh Hussain Taymiyyah. And he would say to the, and he was Qadi, and he's the judge and so on, he would order for him to be killed, and calling him a kafir, and all kinds of evil things, and put him in prison. You know, Shaykh Hussain Taymiyyah, he died in the prison. With all of this, Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah said, when Ibn Makhluf died, when that guy died, Ibn al-Qayyim, the student of Ibn Taymiyyah, he went running to him very happy to give him the good news, that your fierce enemy, that he is a person of bid'ah too, innovation in the deen, such a bad person and so on, he's gone, he's to be happy with him. And when Qayyim rahimahullah, he said that when he came to him and he said this to him, the only thing that Shaykh Hussain Taymiyyah, he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. To Allah belong, to Allah we shall return. ثُمَّ قَامَ, first of all, فَنَهَرَنِي وَتَنَكَّرَنِي. He scolded me, he said, he stopped him from this joy and happiness that he has, and he stopped him from doing this, and he said, إِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. And he went, and he stood up immediately, and he went to the house of this judge, to his family. فَعَزَّاهُمْ, he gave condolences to them, and he said, إِنِّي لَكُمْ مَكَانَهُمْ, I am to you in the position of your father or this person. ولا يكن لكم أمر تحتاجون فيه إلى مساعدة إلا وساعدتكم فيه. And there is nothing that you would need help in unless I would help you with whatever you want. So they were very happy and they made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for him. This is the akhlaq, this is the manners. It doesn't mean that Sheikh Sam Tamiya changed his words and start saying, wallahi the bid'ah that he's saying is okay. There's nobody more firm than him in this. That's why they were so fierce against him, because there was no compromisation in the deen whatsoever. He made the matters very clear and opposed them very clearly. But his personal level of goodness that shows that this was for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was such an amazing thing. Even this Qadi ibn Makhluf himself in his lifetime, he said, when he would order this fight and war against Sheikh Hassan Tamiya, he said, مَا رَأَيْتُ كَرِيمًا, this is his enemy, مَا رَأَيْتُ كَرِيمًا وَاسِعَ الصَّدْرِ مِثْلِ ابْنِ تَمِيَ. He said, I've never seen someone generous and sadr, his chest is so spacious, that means forbearing and forgiving, like Ibn Tamiya. He didn't even say Sheikh or anything, because he's an enemy. And how even some fairness that they had. I've never seen anyone as kind and generous like him. فَقَدْ أَثَرْنَا الدَّوْلَةَ ضُدَّهُ, we got the government against him. وَلَكِنَّهُ عَفَى عَنَّا بَعْدَ مَقْدِرَةٍ, it was a detailed matter, he forgave them after he was in place where he can revenge, because they were with the Khalifa against Sheikh Hassan Tamiya and they put him in prison and so on. And then there was another Khalifa came and took away like a coup against that one. And of course, anytime there's a coup, those who are closest to the Khalifa, they become enemies. So when the other person became in place, and then the same people like them, the same people that were closer to the previous Khalifa, they became the closest to the enemy of the second one, as they usually do, right? So then the first one, he made another coup and he became in charge again. So now he saw that they're just a bunch of going after their own benefits. So he got them all and he got Sheikh Hassan Tamiya out of prison and he put him in charge to, and he asked him, and he put him and he took him away to be alone to tell him, what should I do with these people? Should I kill them? And they're the ones that they were going against him to be killed and so on. And Sheikh Hassan Tamiya, in this incident, he wrote this in his book, he said that I sensed from him that he is going after his own benefit. He's the Khalifa, he doesn't care about, in this particular matter, he cares about his own personal benefit. These people, they betrayed him and so on. So when he sensed this, that this is a personal thing, he started praising them. Sheikh Hassan Tamiya praising them. And he said, if you get rid of them, you won't find any better than them to be with you. And at the same time, that did not make him stop from defending the matters of the deen. But when he sensed, that's the point, the ulama that I mentioned. When he sensed that this was a personal issue, not a matter of deen, it's not for the sake of Allah, this is how he made the matter as clear as we heard. And if we talk about these incidences, it's basically never ends. Sheikh Muhammad, for example, when Abdullah ibn al-Warraq, he said, we were sitting in the majlis of Ahmad ibn Hanbal, and he said to them, من أين أقبلتم, where did you come from? They said, من مجلس أبي قريب, from the majlis of Abi Qurayb. He said, اكتوبوا عنه فإنه رجل صالح. He said to them, write knowledge from him, he's a righteous man. فقلنا إنه أطعن عليك. We said to him that he is attacking you. He said, فأي شيء حيلتي شيخ صالح قد بولي بي. What can I do? A righteous sheikh has been tested by me. So that did not prevent him from saying to them, take ilm from him, take knowledge from him. Just one more example, there are many. Aisha radiallahu anha and Umm Habiba, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know how co-wives, or you know, there's ghira and jealousy and the like of this. She said, Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, da'atni Umm Habiba inda mawtiha. Umm Habiba, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, invited me when she was dying. فقلت أو فقالت قد كان يكون بيننا ما يكون بين الطرائق فغفر الله لي ولك ما كان من ذلك. She said to her when she's dying that there might be some issues between me and you, as what normally happens between al-tara'ikh, the co-wives and the like of this. May Allah forgive me and forgive you. So Aisha, she said, غفر الله لك ذلك كله وحلك من ذلك. She said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive you for all of this, and I have nothing inside of me towards you. فَقَالَتْ سَرَرْتِنِي سَرَّكِ اللَّهِ. She said to her, Muhayyira, you made me happy, may Allah make you happy. Not that, oh, she's the other wife, and I would die like this, and I would never put myself. This is how when things are for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the same thing, Zayn al-Abidin ibn Ali radiallahu anhu, when he had some dispute with one of his cousins. So his cousin came to him when he was in his majlis and started saying things towards him, bad and so on. And Zayn al-Abidin is sitting and quiet and didn't say anything. So when the night came, he went to him, Zayn al-Abidin went to the one that he had transgressed against him. He went to him and he said, Ya ibn Ammi, O my cousin, in kunta sadiqan ghafara Allahu li. If you were truthful in what you said, may Allah forgive you. Wa in kunta kadiban faghafara Allahu lak. And if you're lying, may Allah forgive you. Wassalamu alayhi. Wassalamu alayhi naft. What happened when someone has this, not of course in a disputable manner, but with this concern and the goodness? His cousin, he ran after him. And he grabbed him and he hugged him and he cried and he said, forgive me, and this and that. And this is how the goodness, when it's being presented, when all of these silly things goes away. And this is how they would do this against their own egos and so on, for things to be only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One last thing, inshaAllah ta'ala, since we're talking from the book of Imam Sa'di rahimahullah, Sheikh, one of his son, actually, there's a book about some of the social acts and things like that happened or incidences. He mentioned something about his father, which is Imam Sa'd. He said, اشترى الشيخ الوالد حمل حطب. He purchased logs of wood to burn it for, you know, and so on. And he said that the norm of the people of Unayza, when someone would purchase wood, that the Jamal, the one that carries it on the camels or whatever, he usually takes it inside of the house and he puts it there. And once he finishes, the worker, or the one that's selling the wood, the people of the house would have some dates and water for him. Right? So he would take that. And then, وَإِذَا أَكَلَ وَشَرِبْ يَغْلِقُ بَابَ الْبَيْتِ بِقُوَّةٍ. And whatever, once he eats, he leaves and he closes the gate strongly, so that people would know that he left. And then, for example, the woman, they can come out, so that they know that he left. So in one of these times when he left, the Sheikh Ibn al-Sa'di, he went out to close the door after him. So he found in the house, in the yard of the house, while he's going to the gate, he saw a packet of something. Right away he knew that this was a packet of cigarettes that fell from this man. So he said, قَمَ الْوَلْدُ وَأَخَذَ. He took the packet of cigarettes and he opened the door and he called the Jamal, the guy. And he said to him, this is yours, meaning the pack of cigarettes. So the man said, when he was hesitant, yes, it's mine, but you know what's inside it, right, O Sheikh? He said, yes, دخان, meaning yes, it's cigarettes, which is, of course, haram. And the guy said, and you're giving it to me? Usually, of course, to destroy it, and that's what the action should be done with this. And he said, you're giving it to me? Listen to what he said. And he gave him the lesson and not the outcome. He said, نعم, لأنك إذا ما لقيت العلم سوف تشتري بقيمة الحطب الذي بعته بدلا منها وتجوع عيالك وتحرمه من الرزق والهادي الله سبحانه وتعالى. He said, yes, because he knows of him, that he would still go buy more cigarettes and he would deprive his children and his family from the money that he got, which is their provisions. That means he would not even bring them food tonight so that he can buy cigarettes for it, and he doesn't want to deprive his family from the food. It's a level of fiqh. And it doesn't mean that when you see some pack of cigarettes, you will give it to the one that fell from it. This is not ever, don't do that, basically, right? This is a level of ijtihad in a specific situation, you know him very well. But then when he said this, what did the man say? He said, he took the packet and he threw it and he turned it. And he said, Allahumma inni tubtu ilayk wa lan a'ud ilayhi wa atarakh. Oh Allah, I bet you and I would never do it again. right? So it's the level of concern and sincerity and so on that he showed them and so on. So yani just examples, but there are more to this, what we talked about with the manners of the work of Sheikh Ibn Sa'd rahimahullah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who have good manners, but we'll continue inshallah ta'ala with that tomorrow for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.